Hello, I'm Mishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture, and hopefully the most Renaissance man-like manner in which arts and culture may be discussed, so please stay tuned for that. Now, I didn't intend on making any kind of review video on the happiest day in the life of Olli Mäki, or the Finnish title Hymyilevä Mies, which is a movie directed by Juho Kuosmanen. It was released in... This is something like 2016. So I didn't intend on making any kind of review. If I had such plans, I probably would have done the review earlier to cash in on any possible international interest that this movie might have garnered. Now, if you have never heard of this movie, you might ask, Mishka, why on earth would this movie have any international interest? Well, I don't know. I don't know why any international audience would be interested in this, but because it did win the Prix Un Certain Regard at the Festival de Cannes in 2016. Because it won the Cannes Film Festival basically has three levels, three competition levels. The Palme d'Or series, the Certain Regard series, and then the Director's Fortnight. So Director's Fortnight is basically for shoestring budget films. Certain Regard is like some sort of a silver medal series without any big stars as far as directors or actors are concerned. And then the... Palme d'Or is obviously the series for the movies that the festival programmers have the highest hopes for or just think that are high-profile releases or whatever. And then obviously the festival has movies premiering outside competition series, but Certain Regard is the silver medal series, and this movie, Hymyilevä Mies, is just such a movie that can be there. Because as far as a smaller culture zone like Finland is concerned, Hymyilevä Mies does have fairly good production values, but I'm sure I'm not alone in that I've never heard of Juho Kuosmanen before in my life. And the lead actor Jarkko Lahti, I've never heard of him either. So this would be obscure even in Finland without the... Cannes Festival win. So even in Finland this would be obscure, so it has no prayer of going to the Palme d'Or series, but it's too expensive looking to necessarily go for the Director's Fortnight. So I mean, it's sort of Certain Regard-esque in its presence in the scene. But anyway, so this was released abroad because it got the silver medal series win at Cannes, and I heard Mark Mode, the BBC radio film critic, review this. I can't remember what Mark Mode said because I didn't have that much in. Like I like Dr. Kermode. I have no problems with his film-related opinions. I just, for one reason or another, wasn't entirely paying attention. So I think that he thought that this was pretty good. And I thought this was pretty good. And I'm sure if lots of international audiences watch this, they might think that this is pretty good. Because it's a pretty good movie. Now, that's a really short review, and I don't intend on doing a longer review, even though I will give some thoughts about the movie during this video. But I'd rather talk about the presence that Hymyilevä Mies has in the Finnish film culture. And basically, what it says about Finnish film culture is that if a movie like this can become a big deal... Because I would make the argument that this doesn't need to be a big deal. And I might almost be so harsh as to suggest that if something premiering at the Cannes Film Festival is in the certain regard serious. It's there because it's not designed to be a big deal. If it was designed to be a big deal, it would have been miscategorized if it was placed in the certain regard category. So if the festival programmer saw that, oh wait, there's some hidden gem, obscure masterpiece, we better, you know, bump it up to be a dark horse in the Palme d'Or series. I don't know whether the festival ever does that for completely unproven talent, but I am rather skeptical whether any, you know, really big deal releases have been there in the certain regard series. So I think it's beautiful innocence of some Finnish film buffs if they think that the certain regard is some sort of a great seal of approval. Now, we can have whatever thoughts we want about the prestige of the certain regard category, but that's one thing. But then the other thing I would criticize is that the film festival jury selections, it's almost like some sort of a game of musical chairs. So there is this situation that perhaps there's like two or three movies that are somehow significantly vying for the jury's affections. And then there's maybe a couple of individuals in the jury who are in the kind of key position to influence which way the jury turns. So it's not a case that the jury president can just alone, single-handedly decide everything. At least I don't think that it's like that. They are talking collectively that they want something that satisfies everybody. You know, sometimes just a couple of individuals' personal tastes are the deciding factor why something gets the big prize and a couple of other movies get the consolation prizes of whether it's a jury prize or a director prize or whatever. There is a certain kind of randomness to why some films are winning at some given year and why some films aren't. In my review of Ruben Östlund's The Square, I gave some further thoughts about what I think about the winners at the Cannes Film Festival and what I think the cultural relevance in for film festival prizes is. And if for whatever reason you don't want to watch my The Square review, I can just say that I think most film festivals have such a mixed bag with their roster of past winners that I don't really take even the Palme d'Or that seriously anymore. Because the jury president and sometimes the makeup of the jury, I think, has sort of an undue leaning towards some direction. And it doesn't seem like the jury presidents are overtly serious in trying to make sure that the biggest classic in the selection is the film that ends up winning. They just go with their personal taste, and it is whatever. But obviously, for audiences to take some of the stuff too seriously is maybe a bit silly of them. So that's why it shouldn't really mean anything to me or necessarily to anyone else that a film managed to take some prize home from a film festival. So, you know, some of the movies that have been winning at the Cannes Film Festival, like Visconti's Leopard or Taxi Driver or Apocalypse Now, you know, there are legendary winners, but not every winner is legendary, so that's why it's a mixed bag. So you don't entirely know what the legendary ness of a project is just because it won some award that at different times has slightly different prestige levels to it. So that's my opinions about film festivals. Then the other thing that I'd like to talk about with regards to Hymyilevä Mies is that I think Finnish people are rather putting the cart before the horse if they take foreigners' opinions about Finnish movies too seriously. So I would make the argument that the reason why foreigners don't particularly care about Finnish releases is because the people who make up the film culture in Finland do things that are exclusively easy, simple, and conventional. And when you do something in an easy, simple, and conventional manner, you get slight and conventional results. And those slight and conventional results won't really win over hearts and minds in the international scene. So if Finland has some slight conventional releases, what market isn't oversaturated with slight and conventional movies? Like, you don't even need movies because television is pumping out some slight and conventional programming out there so that there's no over-demand for it. And because Finnish cinema is doing slight and conventional releases, they are doing something for which there isn't a great demand outside Finland. So the only reason why Finnish cinema is doing well in Finland is because the natives have a sentimental attachment to storytelling in their own language, and they are supporting it like some group of Eagle Scouts who want to do the right thing to some sort of a higher extent. And so the Boy Scout nature of some of the people in the Finnish art scene is basically like that. That combined with the state grants that production companies in Finland are having. That's the only reason why Finnish production companies haven't gone bankrupt, because the type of releases that they have shouldn't be the type of stuff that is that makes them able to fight off bankruptcy. So the argument that I'm making is that if Finnish film people want somehow completely different results, they should change the way they practice their craft somehow significantly. Because if you keep doing the same thing and expecting different results, it's more than Dr. Phil who thinks that you're crazy. I mean, it's not a good strategy. And basically, if Finnish people want the kind of scene where they keep doing the same thing and they just wait for some random foreigners to come in and rescue Finnish movies for cultural, global relevance, well, either it's not going to happen, or in some rare cases like this, it will happen, but it doesn't really deserve to happen. So this movie gets to ride on the coattails of some sort of a general legacy that the Cannes Film Festival has as a brand. So to the extent that Cannes Film Festival winners have cultural relevance abroad, a movie like this having won at that festival has some relevance abroad, but it doesn't really deserve to have it. So if I compare this to a couple of other new Finnish releases that, if this movie is a rather wry comedy drama about a very earnest country boy, because some people are pulling the strings behind the scene, a very earnest country boy is pushed into the international spotlight momentarily in the form of a boxing title fight. And basically, this is like a fish out of water comedy about how it is that a country boy with his almost saintly, earnest presence is dealing with the not exactly saintly, not exactly earnest, big leagues and city life and whatever. So it's a very simple movie. It has a really simple presence, and basically the black and white cinematography, I think, is what's mostly making this movie somehow special. So if we take some sort of a black and white drama from recent years of Finnish cinema with some slight new wave undertones, because even though I think that this is a pretty straightforward comedy drama, I think that how it's shot, I think I couldn't help but to think that there is like some sort of a very faint new wave connection. And there's a couple of other Finnish releases from recent decades that I like that. There's a movie called Palkkasoturi, which literally translates to Soldier of Fortune, directed by Anssi Mänttäri, which would be a really straightforward, like a rather obscure comedy of manners on some level. And the black and white cinematography in it does sort of push it into perhaps resembling some of the more straightforward efforts from, let's say, early Chabrol or Godard. A movie like Betoniyö by Pirjo Honkasalo, again, because it's shot in black and white, it perhaps appears more like an art film than it would if it was in color. And, you know, like Betoniyö, I would describe it as if somebody tried to combine Scorsese's Mean Streets, Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, and Raging Bull. If somebody tried to combine those three Scorsese movies into one, and they had a slightly uneasy existence together, like sometimes, you know, it's dancing in slow motion to opera arias, and sometimes it's, you know, two brothers, almost bonding in spite of themselves whilst, you know, doing some boxing routines or something, like, you know, the older brother telling the younger one that he needs to keep his guard up and something, and then saying that, get out of here, I don't wanna look at you again, go buy me, you know, cigarettes or something. Like, I'd say that Betoniyö has a more self-conscious arthouse presence than either Hymyilevä Mies or Mänttäri's Palkkasoturi, but the modern movie shot in black and white in a somewhat restrained, graceful direction, it does sort of put those three movies as if in some kind of accidental continuum with one another. And basically, Hymyilevä Mies is probably the movie out of those three that people would have most likely have heard about, and then Betoniyö, the movie that people probably would have would also have some sort of a chance of having heard about, but Palkkasoturi is completely obscure. And basically, I would suggest that there's completely random rhyme and reason as to why some people have heard of Hymyilevä Mies but haven't heard of Palkkasoturi. So there's absolutely no qualitative difference as far as I'm concerned between those three movies. I would say that Betoniyö is the one which has the most kind of, you know, high or low type presence, that some of the scenes are excellent and other scenes I think completely drop the ball. Whereas I think Palkkasoturi and Hymyilevä Mies are kind of, you know, steady as they go type releases. But basically I think that Finnish cinema does keep producing films in that vein every now and then. And so there shouldn't be anything particularly special about it. And again, there's just complete randomness as to what movie manages to win some sort of a game of musical chairs, where there's like 10 movies that are sort of an equal qualitative presence, but then one of them sort of fails upwards and becomes a bigger deal than perhaps it should be, and as it were moves up a weight class and is there slightly punching above their weight in the international series. But anyway, like Finnish cinema does keep doing stuff like this every now and then, but like we don't have a proper strategy of entering the international scene, and I don't think necessarily other smaller countries have any better strategy. It's just the case that the Hungarian cinema might have every now and then a couple of directors who they have an eccentric style and they stick to their guns, and because they have a sui generis presence, they become a big deal in the international scene. So again, because there's a couple of directors like Miklos Janks or Bellatar who they don't just do easy, simple and conventional. They have some sort of a more distinct brand, and then they can enter the international marketplace as something that, you know, no one in Hollywood is making movies like Bellatar. No one in Britain is making movies like Miklos Janks or something. So that's why a couple of Hungarian directors can, you know, enter the international conversation, and that should basically be the Finnish strategy as well, if anyone would care to do it. So, you know, certainly abandon the easy conventional decisions and take bigger artistic risks as smaller cultures on, and that should do it. But I don't know if there is that much to be said about this movie, because like as I was watching it, the thought that kept going through my mind is that you know, as it went from one moment to another, I just thought that everything about this movie was pretty good. The writing was pretty good, the direction was pretty good. I did like the cinematography to a slightly higher extent, but like the production values were pretty good, everything was pretty good, and so it's not really inspiring me to talk too much about it. But yeah, certainly the film culture around this, it's not pretty good, because like there would be Finnish directors throughout the history of Finnish cinema who would be able to have some sort of a sui generis presence, and arguably if some directors like Erkki Karu or Rauni Mullberg or Aki Kaurismäki, if they would be able to get some kind of international recognition, it would be because they are somehow unique, and because other countries don't quite have Rauni Mullberg making movies there, that's why there might be some sense to import Mulberry movies from Finland, or Kaurismäki, or Erkki Karu, or whatever. So I think that there is a tremendous amount of unique talent scattered there over the Finnish film scene, and I'm trying to find those, and I have nothing against movies like this, but to me this is kind of a secondary release from Finland, in that it's just not unique enough to warrant some sort of a higher interest. But you know, I do want to note that I thought this was pretty good. I feel somehow wrong saying that, but I can't praise the movie any more than it seemed to me. You know, it is what it is. But anyway, like I was looking at some of the cast and crew credits at IMDb.com, and I noticed that a Finnish director called Dome Karukoski has been making a movie about J.R.R. Tolkien, starring Nicholas Hoult and some other British talent. Derek Jacobi seems to be in that movie. Karukoski had been attached to some Keanu Reeves movie called The Starling, and Star, as in like star, like Estrella, you know, not the communist leader from Soviet Union. Karukoski had been attached to a couple of those movies, and then you know, shockingly, the director of the 1999 release Historiaa tehdään nyt öisin, Ilkka Järvilaturi, had been attached to a Chinese movie with Joan Chen and Tony Kafai Long, and it's like every now and then, you know, there seems to be this kind of international openings that a couple of Finnish directors might have a chance to do something abroad. And, you know, I'm happy if Dome Karukoski gets something going internationally. I'm happy if Ilkka Järvilaturi gets something going internationally. But moves like this won't significantly alter anything about the Finnish film culture. We need to be able to have a more specific brand of cinema if you want the international marketplace to open. And because the Finnish brand right now is to do simple, easy, inconsequential, conventional releases, that's not good enough for the international marketplace. So we need to start making big cultural changes in Finland. And not just hope that a couple of movies here and there win the game of musical chairs, or a couple of directors here and there, you know, get the career going. Because, you know, it's just like I had one viewer tell me in my early videos that he didn't appreciate that I basically said that Swedish film culture isn't any better than Finnish film culture just because, you know, Stellan Skarsgård and Ingrid Bergman and Greta Garbo had a couple of significant international movies. Like, it's just, those are like afterthoughts to a film culture. Like, when people press French film culture, they talk about movies made in France. They don't talk about how this one composer, you know, what is it, Alexander Desplat, like, he's having a movie, he's having a successful career in Hollywood. Like, the French film culture either rises or falls based on their domestic releases, and, you know, international careers and all of that. Like, if Matthew Amalric has a Hollywood career, that's nice, but it doesn't really significantly change anything. Like, for no serious film culture, like, it shouldn't make any difference, like, whether somebody's having international, you know, commissions or not. Like, that's beside the point. The main point is what the ground level of the film culture is in the country that it's happening. Like, if film culture consists of the professional filmmakers, the, you know, middleman in media, and then the film fans and just normal people in the audience. Like, it's what matters isn't getting some Greta Garbo, Stellan Skarsgård win the game of musical chairs and have a international career. You know, Christoph Waltz isn't drastically changing the film culture in his country of origin. Like, it doesn't really matter like that. So, you know, people should ignore those games of musical chairs and ignore the winners and losers in that and focus on what the median qualitative level of a given professional or media middleman or an audience member in the country of origin, what the median qualitative level for those people are. You know, there's the saying that something like a team is only as good as its weakest link or something. Like, I think that that's not terribly realistic if you look at a film culture. Like, in a smaller context, something like that might work. But in a bigger, you know, nationwide or international context, I'd say that the median quality level is what decides the situation. Like, you know, a couple of exceptional individuals can make a difference and can win over hearts and minds and whatever. But, you know, like, Spanish film culture wasn't somehow saved just because Luis Buñuel was that exceptional individual. So it's the median level of the different participants that makes a difference. And it's not until you get the median level of those operators to change, to start making some sort of a difference. And then, you know, people just need to be somehow more passionate, more engaged in the whole situation. If every professional, every media member, every audience member has some sort of a sluggish presence, then all of that sluggishness translates into a completely sluggish, trivial film culture. And that's why what we're having, because we just don't make significant enough contributions. And so it's nice when movies like this are winning. It's nice if somebody like Tome Karukoski can have an international career, but that's beside the point. We need to start looking at what's happening on the ground level, what the passion levels, what the competence levels are on the ground level in a randomly chosen professional. And we need to start making a change in that. And, you know, movies like this won't really impact things that much. So that's why I'm not overly focusing on contributions like this. But as I said, I thought this was pretty good. And I just wanted to share that. Now, that's all for now. Thanks for watching, and bye-bye.